chance to talk about the social and literary background of Mrs. Dalloway and about the ideology and philosophies lying behind the novel and behind the modernist novel in general. It's time to look at this novel specifically. And we will be looking at the way that, as we talked about previously, Virginia Woolf intends for us to see two different complementary versions of the truth represented by Clarissa Dalloway's understanding of her world and Septimus Smith's understanding of the world. Early in the novel, as Clarissa Dalloway is heading to the shop to buy flowers for her party that night, she passes by a bookstore. And as she passes by the bookstore, several books catch her eyes. One of them, sort of humorously, is Jorrocks' Johnson Jollities, the book that became the background for the Pickwick Papers when Chapman and Hall hired young Dickens to try to replicate the success of that earlier graphic novel. In the window of the bookstore, Clarissa also sees displayed a volume of Shakespeare's plays. And the lines that she sees, which we see in the book, are from the play Cymbeline. And the lines that we see are from a poem that is read over the supposedly dead body of a character, who, however, is not actually dead. The lines are, "Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor furious winter's rages." And that points out one of the dominant underlying themes of this novel, and that is the significance of death. Now, obviously, death is the great equalizer. We all die. The rich, the powerful, the poor, all equally die in time. So death is the one thing that connects everyone. It's the great leveler. Not only is death the great equalizer, but it's also the thing that we all have in common. It's the one thing that binds us all together. It's the one great truth that we all face. And in this novel, it actually turns out to be a sort of an escape for Septimus, an escape not from insanity, but in fact, in this case, it's an escape from sanity. It's an escape from the real world when Septimus's insanity has failed him. But in this novel, death is the one thing that binds us all together, and it's the one thing that Clarissa is able to help overcome in her way by establishing a common bond with other people. In some ways, Clarissa's gift, as she calls it, her gift to society, is her ability to bind people together through her parties. And it's also the thing that binds her together with Septimus, although they never meet in the novel. And Clarissa hears only of his death at second hand from Sir William Bradshaw when he shows up at her party. Nevertheless, she feels that Septimus's death is a sort of gift to her. He threw it all away and allowed her to feel the meaning in life. So even in Septimus's death is he able to establish a common bond. The purpose of this novel is to show that in the absence of some transcendental meaning or eternal existence which gives our lives meaning, we have to establish meaning in our own lives. And we establish that meaning in our lives by binding ourselves to others through social contacts. And those are the social contacts that Virginia Woolf has Clarissa Dalloway construct. It's very similar to what Dickens does for Scrooge at the end of A Christmas Carol, where the ghost of Christmas yet to come proves that if he does not establish some sort of social network, a group of people who will remember him, he will die ignominiously and be forgotten, and it will be as though he never existed. It's very much a sort of pagan afterlife. It's an afterlife that we create for ourselves through our contacts with others. I'm borrowing and adapting this reading about the significance of death in Mrs. Dalloway from literary scholar and critic J. Hillis Miller in his book Fiction and Repetition, and his chapter on Mrs. Dalloway called Repetition and the Raising of the Dead. One of the elements of this novel that can make it seem confusing is actually one of its narrative strengths, which is that it's able to offer us a variety of different perspectives by shifting from character to character. This allows Woolf to not only show us multiple perspectives on an event, like Clarissa and Peter shared but different memories of when Peter proposed and Clarissa turned him down, but also can take us inside and outside of a character. So at one moment we'll see the character thinking, and at the next moment we'll see how that character appears to someone from the outside. As when we shift quickly from Septimus in the park to Peter seeing Septimus and Rizzia arguing. So let's look at one scene just to see how this works.
She remembers Peter Walsh, and then she stops on the curb. She stiffened a little on the curb, waiting for a Durnell's van to pass. A charming woman, Scrope Purvis thought her, knowing her as one does know people who live next door to one in Winchester. A touch of the bird about her, of the jay, blue-green light, vivacious, though she was over 50 and grown very white since her illness. There she perched, never seeing him, waiting to cross, very upright. For, having lived in Westminster, how many years now, over 20, one feels even in the midst of the traffic, or waking at night, Clarissa was positive. So what happens here is we have Clarissa remembering Peter, stopping on the curb. We skip into the mind of her neighbor, Scrope Purvis, who sees her. And so we get an outside perspective of Clarissa from Scrope Purvis's perspective. And then in the next paragraph, we jump right back into Clarissa's mind. So we're jumping from mind to mind. So one of the challenges of reading this novel is that you have to keep track of who's thinking when, because we'll skip into the minds of people. Sometimes they're very important people. It's Clarissa, or Peter Walsh, or Rizzia, or Septimus Smith. But sometimes it's just Maggie the flower girl. And we'll just skip into her mind for a moment and see it from her perspective. So one of the challenges of the novel is paying attention to whose world you're seeing at any particular moment.
The next challenge of which one should be aware is the progression of time. Because, as I mentioned in the previous video, time marches forward irrevocably as Big Ben strikes. But experiential time, that notion of duration promoted by philosopher Henri Bergson, is much more fluid and moves in a much less linear fashion. So as we're moving forward in the narrative, we're also moving backward in the characters' memories and experiences, and we're introduced into this progression very early in the novel. If we look at the third paragraph, we have Clarissa leaving her house to go buy the flowers for her party. And as she walks out of the doors of her house, it immediately reminds her of her much younger self leaving the doors of their vacation home at Burton, which was the location of her experience, which will shape this novel, of her proposal and ultimate rejection of that proposal of Peter Walsh, and her decision to marry Richard Dalloway, which turns out to be a very formative decision in her character, and one that Peter Walsh himself sees as a failure, what he calls later in the novel, the death of her soul. In the third paragraph, it starts out, "What a lark, what a plunge, for so it had always seemed to her, when with a little squeak of the hinges, which he could hear now, she had burst open the French windows and plunged at Burton into the open air." So even as she's moving forward now toward her party that evening and going off to buy flowers, she's also moving backwards in her memory to this important experience of Burton. "How fresh, how calm, stiller than this, of course, the air was in the early morning, like the flap of the wave, the kiss of a wave, chill and sharp, and yet for a girl of 18 as she then was, solemn, feeling as she did, standing there at the open window, that something awful was about to happen, looking at the flowers, at the trees with smoke winding off them, and the rooks rising, falling, standing and looking, until Peter Walsh said, 'Musing among the vegetables, was that it? I prefer men to cauliflowers, was that it?' He must have said it at breakfast one morning when she had gone out to the terrace, Peter Walsh." And so we're introduced now not only to Clarissa's present, but also to Clarissa's very important and formative past. The moment when she remembers when she was a girl of 18 that something awful was about to happen, and that something awful turns out to be Peter Walsh's proposal. And we'll revisit this scene later from Peter's memory, as he remembers what was going on. And also later, Clarissa will look back at this scene when Peter disrupts her conversation with Sally Seton. So even as we're moving forward in the novel, we're also moving backwards in the memories of these characters to reconstruct the past, which has shaped the present. So time in this sense is very fluid. Another way that time is very fluid is this constant repetition in the novel. And as J. Hillis Miller pointed out in his book, Fiction and Repetition, this novel is constantly repeating things. Different characters are thinking similar things. Especially Clarissa and Septimus will say some of the same things, in some cases almost identically. So the novel is constantly repeating itself, and images keep returning, which creates this much more cyclic notion of time, rather than time being this constant and irrevocable movement forward marked by the leaden circles of Big Ben dissolving in the air. Time keeps folding back on itself and reminding us of previous moments. So, for example, this moment when Clarissa remembers Peter Walsh at Burton saying something along the lines of, "Musing among the vegetables, was that it? I prefer men to cauliflowers, was that it?" And then on the next page, she says, "How strange it was, a few sayings like this about cabbages, and the cauliflowers now become cabbages." Later, we will see this passage come back. On page 325, we have this passage. Only this time, Clarissa's not there. This time, it's Sally Seton and Peter Walsh. That was one of the bonds between Sally and himself. There was a garden where they used to walk, a walled-in place with rose bushes and giant cauliflowers. He could remember Sally tearing off a rose, stopping to exclaim at the beauty of the cabbage leaves in the moonlight. It was extraordinary how it all came back to him, things he hadn't thought of for years. And so, once again, we have this minor detail of the giant cauliflowers and the cabbage leaves. Then, on page 388, at Clarissa's party, when Peter again meets Lady Rossiter, who turns out to be Sally Seton, married with five sons, he thinks, "Lord, Lord, what a change had come over, the softness of motherhood, its egotism too. Last time they had met, Peter remembered, had been among the cauliflowers in the moonlight, the leaves like rough bronze," she had said with her literary term, "and she had picked a rose." And then later, on page 391, Sally remembers the same scene. And this, in fact, echoes the memory of Clarissa in the opening pages of the novel. When Sally remembers Peter making the statement that Clarissa can't remember clearly in the third paragraph of the novel. Despairing of human relationships, people were so difficult, she often went into the garden and got from her flowers a piece which men and women never gave her. But no, he did not like cabbages. He preferred human beings, Peter said. And that's the actual passage that Clarissa had remembered. So these memories bind these people together and also bind the narrative together as they keep popping back up over and over throughout the narrative. Another passage that is echoed throughout the narrative is Clarissa's memory of when Peter Walsh called her the perfect hostess. And this appears the first time on page 287, where she remembers their argument, she and Peter arguing at Burton. How they argued. She would marry a prime minister and stand at the top of a staircase. The perfect hostess, he called her. She had cried over it in her bedroom. She had the makings of a perfect hostess, he said. A few pages later, on page 292, the passage pops up again. This time Clarissa is anticipating how she will appear when she shows up at her own party, indicating that she has indeed become the perfect hostess. And Clarissa, too, gave a party. She stiffened a little, so she would stand at the top of her stairs, echoing Peter's line about standing at the top of the stairs, the perfect hostess. It pops up again later in Peter's memory. On page 318, Peter remembers the same scene. Afterwards, he could remember standing by old Miss Perry's chair in the drawing room. Clarissa came up with her perfect manners, like a real hostess, and wanted to introduce him to someone, spoke as if they had never met before, which enraged him. Yet even then he admired her for it. He admired her courage, her social instinct. He admired her power of carrying things through. The perfect hostess, he said to her, whereupon she winced all over. But he meant her to feel it. He would have done anything to hurt her after seeing her with Dalloway. So she left him. And he had a feeling that they were all gathered together in a conspiracy against him, laughing and talking behind his back. And so the same scene comes up in Clarissa's memory, and it also comes up in Peter's memory. And they each remember and reveal how and why they felt about this event, each from their own perspective. And of course, all of this points to the end of this novel, where indeed Clarissa turns out to be the perfect hostess, hosting this party which draws these people together. Another element that's repeated throughout this novel is the notion of solitude, separation, alienation, or loneliness, which occurs to all of the characters at some point in the novel. We're introduced to it the first time on page 287 when Clarissa is remembering Peter and his proposal and why she had decided not to marry him. And she says, right after the passage where she remembers Peter calling her the perfect hostess, "So she would still find herself arguing in St. James Park, still making out that she had been right. And she had, too, not to marry him. For in marriage, a little license, a little independence there must be between people living together, day in and day out in the same house, which Richard gave her, and she him. But with Peter, everything had to be shared, everything gone into, and it was intolerable. And when it came to that scene in the little garden by the fountain, she had to break with him, or they would have been destroyed. Both of them ruined, she was convinced, though she had borne about with her for years like an arrow sticking in her heart, the grief, the anguish, and then the horror of that moment when someone told her at a concert that he had married a woman he met on the boat going to India. Never should she forget all that. Cold, heartless, a prude, he called her. Never could she understand how he cared. So we get this idea that Clarissa feels the need for separation or alienation, but that also becomes a cost when we talk about solitude. This isolation and alienation, even from her husband, becomes more fully developed at the bottom of page 300 and top of page 301 when Clarissa muses upon the separation between she and her husband, Richard, which she had chosen over the too close relationship between she and Peter Walsh. Of course, we also should know that Clarissa has some sort of heart illness, which, like the supposed condition of the wife of the narrator of The Good Soldier, means that she needs to sleep alone. So at the bottom of page 300, "For the house sat so long that Richard insisted after her illness that she sleep undisturbed. And really, she preferred to read of the retreat from Moscow. He knew it. So the room was an attic, the bed narrow, and lying there reading, for she slept badly, she could not dispel a virginity preserved through childbirth, which clung to her like a sheet. Lovely in girlhood, suddenly there came a moment, for example, on the river beneath the woods at Clevedon, when, through some contraction of this cold spirit, she had failed him. And then at Constantinople, and then again and again. She could see what she lacked. It was not beauty, it was not mind. It was something central which permeated, something warm which broke up surfaces and rippled the cold contact of a man and woman, or of women together." So again, we have images that suggest the separation between humans that must be overcome in order to rebuild human society. To some extent, Clarissa's loneliness comes as a result of her own personal failure. We just looked at the passage in which she talked about her failure for Richard, where she contracted in a virginity that comes from childbirth. But in fact, she tends to run away from human connection altogether. We're offered in the novel two different versions of Clarissa Dalloway. One version of Clarissa that could have been with Peter and would have lived a full life that she now regrets having lost. And then the other version is the version that has within it that fear that retreats into conservatism. And the conservatism, we will see, ultimately is the enemy represented by Sir William Bradshaw, whom we'll talk about later. So Clarissa has this possibility, the potential of becoming the bohemian woman who lives a free lifestyle. But she also deals with the fear of fighting conventionality. And that choice that ends up defining who she is and ends up costing her the kinds of connections that she desires. The evidence of this comes in her rejection of Peter and also in her potential relationship with Sally Seton. She could see what she lacked. It was not beauty, it was not mind, it was something central which permeated, something warm which broke up surfaces and rippled the cold contact of a man and women or of women together. What she lacks is the ability to break through those barriers that we'll see also with the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock between humans and society. For that she could dimly perceive. She resented it, had a scruple picked up heaven knows where, or as she felt sent by nature, who is invariably wise. What she talks about here as the scruple is the thing that ends up violating her or damaging her relationship with Peter. Yet she could not resist sometimes yielding to the charm of a woman, not a girl, of a woman confessing, as to her they often did, some scrape, some folly. And whether it was pity or their beauty or that she was older or some accident, like a faint scent or a violin next door, so strange is the power of sounds at certain moments, she did undoubtedly then feel what men felt, only for a moment, but it was enough. It was a sudden revelation, a tinge like a blush, which one tried to check, and then as it spread, one yielded to its expansion and rushed to the farthest verge and there quivered and felt the world come closer, swollen with some astonishing significance, some pressure of rapture, which split its thin skin and gushed and poured with an extraordinary alleviation over the cracks and sores. Then for that moment she had almost seen an illumination, a match burning in a crocus, an inner meaning almost expressed. But the close withdrew, the hard softened, it was over, the moment. Against such moments, with women too, they're contrasted, as she laid her hat down, the bed and Baron Marbot and the candle half burnt. But this question of love, she thought, putting her coat away, this falling in love with women, take Sally Seton, her relation in the old days with Sally Seton, had that not, after all, been love? And then we get a couple of paragraphs describing Clarissa's impressions of Sally as this bohemian, unconventional iconoclast who is impulsive and does things without considering what other people will think. And this represents Clarissa's other side, her potential, her ability to think outside of social barriers and boundaries. And it's represented in the fact that for Clarissa, she feels something very much like she believes love for Sally. She says on the next page, but the charm was overpowering to her at least, so that she could remember standing in her bedroom at the top of the house, holding the hot water can in her hands and saying aloud, she is beneath this roof. She is beneath this roof. No, the words meant absolutely nothing to her now. She could not even get an echo of an old emotion. But she could remember going cold with excitement and doing her hair in a kind of ecstasy. Now the old feeling began to come back to her. She took out her hairpins, laid them on the dressing table, began to do her hair, with the rooks floating up and down in the pink evening light and dressing and going downstairs and feeling as she crossed the hall, if it were now to die, 'twere to be most happy. That was her feeling, Othello's feeling, and she felt it. She was convinced, as strongly as Shakespeare meant Othello to feel it, all because she was coming down to dinner in a white frock to meet Sally Seton. And then skip further a little down. She and Sally fell behind. Then came the most exquisite moment of her whole life, passing a stone urn with flowers in it. Sally stopped, picked a flower, kissed her on the lips. The whole world might have turned upside down. The others disappeared. There she was alone with Sally, and she felt that she had been given a present, wrapped up and told just to keep it, not to look at it, a diamond, something infinitely precious, wrapped up, which as they walked up and down, she uncovered, or the radiance burnt through, the revelation, the religious feeling. When old Joseph and Peter faced them, stargazing, said Peter. It was like running one's face against a granite wall in darkness. It was shocking. It was horrible. So Clarissa has this potential of becoming something greater, someone who is able to connect with other people. But she fails because she has within her also this scruple, as she describes it, that binds her to conventionality. And Peter recognizes this as well. Peter remembers the moment when she chose Richard over him as he says it, the death of the soul. We get a section with Septimus Smith and Lucrezia in the park. And as they're in the park, Peter is also in the park and he falls asleep on a bench. And he wakes up having been dreaming of Clarissa. He woke with extreme suddenness, saying to himself, the death of the soul. Lord, Lord, he said to himself out loud, stretching and opening his eyes, the death of the soul. The words detached themselves to some scene, to some room, to some past he had been dreaming of. It became clearer, the scene, the room, the past he had been dreaming of. It was at Burton that summer, early in the 90s, when he was so passionately in love with Clarissa. So in thinking about what he says is the death of Clarissa's soul, he is remembering a scene in which a group of people were sitting at Burton in the 90s, in that time that Clarissa has been remembering as well, the summer during which Peter proposed to her and she turned him down, when a group of people were sitting around talking about one of the neighboring squires who had married his housemaid, very much in a Jane Eyre, Pamela sort of way. And in fact, probably Virginia Woolf is actually thinking to some extent about Jane Eyre. And she had been brought to visit and it had been very uncomfortable. And Sally Seton, who is the unconventional one, points out that before they'd married, she'd had a baby, which obviously means that they had had extramarital relationship in those days in mixed company. It was a bold thing to say. He could see Clarissa now turning bright pink, somehow contracting and saying, oh, I shall never be able to speak to her again. whereupon the whole party sitting around the tea table seemed to wobble and was very uncomfortable. He hadn't blamed her for minding the fact, since in those days a girl brought up as she was knew nothing, but it was her manner that annoyed him, timid, hard, something arrogant, unimaginative, prudish. The death of the soul, he had said that instinctively, taking the moment as he used to, the death of her soul. So this is one of the moments that marks off for Peter the fact that Clarissa has within her that hard, cold, selfish, conservative factor that will end up blocking their successful relationship. And so as a result, Clarissa retreats into becoming Mrs. Richard Dalloway and loses that portion of her which could have been an adventurous, free-spirited person, becoming conventional and the wife of a prominent social leader. And this conventionality contributes to her solitude, since she lacks that thing which ripples barriers and boundaries between people and ends up leaving her alone, since conventional relationships are alienated and separate. On page 309, after Peter Walsh comes to visit her in the present, he drops in on her. Peter leaves and she considers what her life might have been had she married him, because now apparently her life is lonely. It was all over for her. The sheet was stretched and the bed narrow. She had gone up into the tower alone and left them blackberrying in the sun. The door had shut, and there among the dust of fallen plaster and the litter of birds' nests, now distant, the view had looked, and the sounds came thin and chill. Once on Leith Hill, she remembered, and Richard, Richard, she cried as a sleeper in the night starts and stretches a hand in the dark for help. Lynching with Lady Bruton, it came back upon her. He has left me. I am alone forever, she thought, folding her hands upon her knee. Moving back to page 296, we have Lucrezia Warren Smith, Septimus's Italian wife, experiencing a similar emotion when she's in the park with her husband who is experiencing post-traumatic stress disorder or shell shock. She says, "To love makes one solitary," she thought. She spread her hand before her. Look, her wedding ring slipped. She had grown so thin. It was she who suffered, but she had nobody to tell. Septimus also feels this sense of solitude. Immediately after Rita talks about the fact that she had nobody to tell, the narrative shifts into Septimus's perception, and he hears Rita talking to him, and she says, "For you should see the Milan garden," she said aloud. But to whom? There was nobody. Her words faded. And that's Septimus recognizing that there's nobody there. Now, literally, she's not talking to anybody who's listening, but also there's this sense that nobody hears. There is nobody. Then finally, on page 364, just before Septimus kills himself, at the moment where he regains his sanity, his recognition, the recognition that causes him to kill himself, is his recognition of his loneliness. He started up in terror. What did he see? The plate of bananas on the sideboard? Nobody was there. Rizzi had taken the child to its mother. It was bedtime. That was it. To be alone forever. That was the doom pronounced in Milan when he came into the room and saw them cutting out buckram shapes with their scissors. To be alone forever. He was alone with the sideboard and the bananas. He was alone, exposed on this bleak eminence, stretched out, but not on a hilltop, not on a crag, on Mrs. Filmer's sitting room sofa. So Septimus experiences the solitude that had also isolated Clarissa. It's also important to point out in this scene, which immediately precedes Septimus's decision to kill himself, that he kills himself to escape the solitude, not because he's crazy, but because he has become sane. His insanity was an attempt to overcome the solitude by communicating with the dead, a topic that we'll return to later in this discussion. If we go further in the passage, you'll notice that he recognizes that his previous delusions were only that, were delusions, and now he recognizes that Evans wasn't really there, and those things he was seeing from the world of the dead were not real. As for the visions, the faces, the voices of the dead, where were they? There was a screen in front of him, with black bulrushes and blue swallows. Where he had once seen mountains, where he had seen faces, where he had seen beauty, there was a screen. And the screen, of course, is one of those room dividers covered with fabric that you set up to block light or to set up conversation areas or to block heat from the fire. And before he'd been looking at the screen and seeing these beautiful images, but now he sees only the screen. "Evans," he cried. There was no answer. A mouse had squeaked or a curtain rustled. Those were the voices of the dead. the screen, the coal scuttle. The sideboard remained to him. Let him face the screen, the coal scuttle, and the sideboard. But Rizzia burst into the room, chattering. What before had been the voices of the dead, those things that had connected him to other people, now become simply a mouse squeaking or a curtain rustling. And so Septimus is seeing stark reality and recognizing the solitude and isolation to be alone forever that comes from being sane. So the circumstance that Clarissa and Septimus deal with in this novel is this problem of solitude, the problem of isolation and alienation, of being alone. And this is the problem that permeates modernist society, that ultimately we are all separated from one another in some essential way. This recognition comes most clearly, though in an insane form, to Septimus. Remember that in her notes for the novel, Virginia Woolf said, Mrs. D seeing the truth, SS, Septimus Smith, seeing the insane truth. And so Septimus's perception of society is a distorted mirror version of what Clarissa sees about her society. So we have to understand something about who Septimus is. If we skip back to page 331, we get an introduction to the sane Septimus before the war. We have been told already that Septimus was a young man, somewhat serious young man, who has fallen in love with the woman who teaches Shakespeare, Miss Isabel Pohl, and has been writing her love letters, which she corrects in red ink without commenting upon the contents. Septimus, like many young men, volunteers to go to the war in order to save an England, which for him is seen in terms of a set of ideals, which mostly consist of Miss Isabel Pohl and Shakespeare's plays. So on page 331, Septimus was one of the first to volunteer. He went to France to save an England which consisted almost entirely of Shakespeare's plays and Miss Isabel Pohl in a green dress walking in a square. There, in the trenches, the change which Mr. Brewer desired when he advised football was produced instantly. He developed manliness, he was promoted, he drew the attention, indeed the affection of his officer, Evans by name. But when Evans, Rizzia, who had only seen him once, called him a quiet man, a sturdy red-haired man, undemonstrative in the company of women, when Evans was killed just before the armistice in Italy, Septimus, far from showing any emotion or recognizing that here was the end of friendship, congratulated himself on feeling very little and very reasonably. The war had taught him. It was sublime. He had gone through the whole show, friendship, European war, death, had won promotion, and was still under 30 and was bound to survive. He was right there. The last shells missed him. He watched them explode with indifference. When peace came, he was in Milan, billeted in the house of an innkeeper with a courtyard, flowers in tubs, little tables in the open, daughters making hats. And to Lucrezia, the younger daughter, he became engaged one evening when the panic was on him that he could not feel. For now that it was all over, truth signed and the dead buried, he had especially in the evening these sudden thunderclaps of fear he could not feel. For now that it was all over, truth signed and the dead buried, he had especially in the evening these sudden thunderclaps of fear he could not feel. As he opened the door of the room where the Italian girls sat making hats, he could see them, he could hear them. They were rubbing wires among colored beads and saucers. They were turning buckram shapes this way and that. The table was all strewn with feathers, spangles, silks, ribbons. Scissors were rapping on the table. But something had failed him. He could not feel. Septimus's first response to the trauma of the war, of course, is desensitization, feeling nothing. But he comes to the conclusion, ultimately, that the problem is not with him, that he himself is perfect. The problem is that there is something wrong with the world. Lucrezia is showing him her hats and flowers and things like that. Beautiful, she would murmur, nudging Septimus that he might see. But beauty was behind a pane of glass, even taste. Rizzia liked ices, chocolate, sweet things, had no relish to him. He put down his cup on the little marble table. He looked at the people outside. Happy they seemed, collecting in the middle of the street, shouting, laughing, squabbling over nothing. But he could not taste, he could not feel. In the tea shop, among the tables and the chattering waiters, the appalling fear came over him. He could not feel. He could reason, he could read Dante, for example, quite easily. Septimus, do put down your book, said Rizzia, gently shutting the inferno. He could add up his bill. His brain was perfect. It must be the fault of the world, then, that he could not feel. It might be possible, Septimus thought, looking at England from the train window as they left New Haven. it might be possible that the world itself is without meaning. And so Septimus's recognition as the result of his war trauma is that there is no essential transcendental meaning. There is no essential necessary connection between human beings. That all of these connections have been destroyed by the trauma of the war. Or perhaps it might be more accurate to say that the war has revealed these connections as illusory. At the bottom of page 333, he expresses this. He watched her snip, shape as one watches a bird hop, flit in the grass without daring to move a finger. For the truth is, let her ignore it, that human beings have neither kindness nor faith nor charity beyond what serves to increase the pleasure of the moment. They hunt in packs. Their packs scour the desert and vanish screaming into the wilderness. They desert the fallen. They are plastered over with grimaces. There was Brewer at the office with his waxed mustache, coral tie pin, white slip, and pleasurable emotions, all coldness and clamminess within, his geraniums ruined in the war, his cook's nerves destroyed, or Amelia, what's her name, handing round cups of tea punctually at 5, a leering, sneering, obscene little harpy, and the Toms and Birdies in their starched shirt fronts oozing thick drops of ice. In the streets, vans roared past him. Brutality blared out on placards. Men were trapped in mines, women burnt alive, and once a maimed file of lunatics being exercised or displayed for the diversion of the populace, who laughed aloud, ambled and nodded and grinned past him in the Tottenham Court Road, each half apologetically, yet triumphantly inflicting his hopeless woe. And would he go mad? Septimus is recognizing that despite the ideals with which he went to the war to save an England, which is represented by Shakespeare's plays and Miss Isabel Pole walking in the square in a red dress, that the actual connections between human beings have been destroyed by the war, or rather that the war has revealed these human connections to be artificial and easily broken. And he believes that what his insanity has showed him is actually the truth. And then that truth has condemned him to death. So there was no excuse, nothing whatever the matter, except the sin for which human nature had condemned him to death, that he did not feel. He had not cared when Evans was killed, that was the worst. But all the other crimes raised their heads and shook their fingers and jeered and sneered over the rail of the bed in the early hours of the morning at his prostrate body, which lay realizing its degradation. How he had married his wife without loving her. He had lied to her, seduced her, outraged Miss Isabel Pole, and was so pocked and marked with vice that women shuddered when they saw him in the street. The verdict of human nature on such a wretch was death. With his recognition of this verdict to death, however, comes the revelation that ultimately reveals to Septimus the insane truth that mirrors Clarissa Dalloway's perceived truth, which is his bond to the dead. Farther down on that page, it was at that moment, reads he had gone shopping, that the great revelation took place. A voice spoke from behind the screen. Evans was speaking. The dead were with him. "Heavens, heavens," he cried. Mr. Smith was talking aloud to himself. "Agnes, the servant girl," cried to Miss Filmer in the kitchen. "Heavens, heavens," he had said when she brought in the tray. She jumped, she did, she scuttled downstairs. And Rizia came in with her flowers and walked across the room and put the roses in a vase upon which the sun struck directly, and it went laughing, leaping around the room. She had to buy the roses, Rizia said, from a poor man in the street. But they were almost dead already, she said, arranging the roses. Talking, of course, about the roses, but echoing Septimus's recognition. "Communication is health. Communication is happiness. Communication," he muttered. Septimus recognizes that the bond he has is with the dead. The dead were with him. And that in order to establish a new human society, communication is necessary. One must communicate. And remember this line much later in the novel when we're looking at Mrs. Dalloway hearing about Septimus's death when she is alone during her party and recognizing his attempt to communicate, because ultimately this is what bonds Septimus and Clarissa together, although they never actually meet in person. Septimus's recognition of the truth of isolation is one that mirrors, in a distorted funhouse mirror sort of way, Clarissa's recognition. Remember, early in the novel, Clarissa had expressed her belief that even when she dies, she will continue to exist in the trees. And that's something that Septimus echoes when they're in the park and Rizia has taken off her wedding ring because it no longer fits. And Septimus recognizes that he is now alone because he interprets this literally as meaning that he is no longer married. He expresses his belief in the truth. The rope was cut. He mounted. He was free, as it was decreed that he, Septimus, the Lord of Men, should be free, alone, since his wife had thrown away her wedding ring, since she had left him. He, Septimus, was alone, called forth in advance of the mass of men to hear the truth, to learn the meaning which now at last, after all the toils of civilization, Greeks, Romans, Shakespeare, Darwin, and now himself, was to be given whole to whom, he asked aloud. To the Prime Minister, the voices which rustled above his head replied. The supreme secret must be told to the cabinet. First, the trees are alive. Next, there is no crime. Next, love, universal love, he muttered, gasping, trembling, painfully drawing out these profound truths which needed, so deep were they, so difficult, an immense effort to speak out. But the world was entirely changed by them forever. Earlier in the novel, on page 295, but later in the chronological progression of the novel, since his initial recognition comes in retrospect, Septimus explains his belief about the trees, again echoing what Clarissa had thought earlier. But they beckoned. Leaves were alive. Trees were alive. And the leaves, being connected by millions of fibers with his own body there on the seat, fanned it up and down. When the branch stretched, he too made that statement. The sparrows fluttering, rising, and falling in jagged fountains were part of the pattern, the white and blue barred with black branches. Sounds made harmonies with premeditation. The spaces between them were as significant as the sounds. A child cried. Rightly far away, a horn sounded. All taken together meant the birth of a new religion. Remember back on page 288, where Clarissa had said, but that somehow in the streets of London, on the ebb and flow of things, here, there, she survived. Peter survived, lived in each other. She being part, she was positive, of the trees at home, of the house there, ugly, rambling to bits and pieces as it was. Part of people she had never met, being laid out like a mist between the people she knew best, who lifted her on their branches as she had seen the trees lift the mist, but it spread ever so far, her life, herself. So Septimus's insight, his revelation, echoes the idea first put forward by Clarissa, that people are connected through the spaces between things, laid out like a mist between people she knew best, who lifted her on their branches as she had seen the trees lift the mist. Septimus, in his insane recognition, recognizes a distorted version of what Clarissa has already said, that we continue to exist spread out in a tissue over the other people and places with which we are associated. So the issue that we're dealing with throughout this novel is the issue of postmodern loneliness and isolation and alienation. People are cut off from one another. And this is a problem that is dealt with in various ways by the different characters, most notably by Clarissa Dalloway on the one hand and Septimus Smith on the other, and in the way they ultimately come together at the end of the novel. Now, there are two things that bring humans together, two things that ultimately replace the loss of some sort of metaphysical or transcendental connection between people in a post-existentialist world. And one of those things is, ironically, the fact that we all die. After all, when Septimus kills himself, he does it not because he's crazy, but because he's sane and because he is escaping the forced conventionality represented by Holmes and Sir William Bradshaw, escaping back to the world of the dead. He doesn't actually want to die, but in his suicide, he returns to his connection with the dead that he had lost as he gained his sanity. In fact, Septimus's repeated claims throughout the novel that he must kill himself or that he will kill himself can be seen as a reflection of his understanding that death is the one thing that connects him with others, not only Evans, but with everyone. Death is the great equalizer, the great leveler, the one thing that ties us all together. All human beings ultimately will die. And this idea of death, it pops up over and over throughout the novel in the repeated references in the novel to lines from Shakespeare's play Cymbeline, which pop up for the first time on page 288. As Clarissa is going to buy her flowers, she walks by a bookstore. In the window of the bookstore, she sees several books. Among them, sitting open, is a copy of Shakespeare's plays. And the passage that strikes her eye is the passage that is taken from a song sung over the supposedly dead body of the heroine Imogen, who is feigning death, but she's not really dead. And the lines are, Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor furious winter's rages. Because, of course, in death, one escapes the pain and suffering of life, as Septimus will ultimately prove later in the novel. And by the way, pay attention to the references to the hot sun or the sun was hot that pop up repeatedly throughout this novel, and pay attention to the context in which those references appear. But the other side of this, of course, is that Imogen isn't really dead. The people who are singing the song don't recognize that she hasn't actually died. And that's the other side of this, that in some ways we continue to survive our own death, but we do it through the tissue of memories that we enact in others. And this is a recognition that Clarissa achieves. If we look at the passage just above this, Clarissa is remembering her youth. She says, "She remembered once throwing a shilling into the serpentine, but everyone remembered. What she loved was this, here now in front of her, the fat lady in the cab. Did it matter then, she asked herself, walking toward Bond Street? Did it matter that she must inevitably cease completely? All this must go on without her? Did she resent it? Or did it not become consoling to believe that death ended absolutely, but that somehow in the streets of London, on the ebb and flow of things, here, there, she survived, Peter survived, lived in each other, she being part, she was positive of the trees at home, of the house there, ugly, rambling all to bits and pieces as it was, part of the people she had never met, being laid out like a mist between the people she knew best, who lifted it on their branches as she had seen the trees lift the mist, but it spread ever so far, her life herself." One survives through the connections one builds with each other and through these memories, because in this novel, memory is everything. Moving forward gains meaning only by moving backward in memory, and memory establishes the connections between people. Later in the novel, on page 368, Peter explains Clarissa's theory of this transcendental connection between people through memory. It was to explain the feeling they had of dissatisfaction, not knowing people, not being known. For how could they know each other? You met every day, then not for 6 months or years. It was unsatisfactory, they agreed, how little one knew people. But she said, sitting on the bus going up Shaftesbury Avenue, she felt herself everywhere. Not here, 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 she tapped the back of the seat, but everywhere. She waved her hand going up Shaftesbury Avenue. She was all that. So that to know her, or anyone, one must seek out the people who completed them. Even the places. Odd affinity she had with people she had never spoken to, some woman in the street, some man behind the counter, even trees or barns. It ended in a transcendental theory which, with her horror of death, allowed her to believe, or say that she believed, for all her skepticism, that since our apparitions, the part of us which appears, are so momentarily compared with the other, the unseen part of us which spreads wide, the unseen might survive, be recovered somehow, attached to this person or that, or even haunting certain places after death. Perhaps. Perhaps. Looking back over that long friendship of almost 30 years, her theory worked to this extent. Brief, broken, often painful as their actual meetings had been, what with his absences and interruptions. This morning, for instance, in came Elizabeth like a long-legged colt, handsome, dumb, just as he was beginning to talk to Clarissa. The effect of them on this life was immeasurable. There was no mystery about it. You were given a sharp, acute, uncomfortable grain, the actual meeting, horribly painful as often as not. Yet in absence, in the most unlikely places, it would flower out, open, shed its scent, let you touch, taste, look about you, get the whole feel of it, an understanding after years of lying loss. These common memories and associations can also tie together people who don't know each other, as they establish the common culture that binds the people together in their common associations regarding their society, but also their common memories of the lost dead. Slightly later in the novel, as Clarissa is going to the shop to buy the flowers, a car of some notable personage, it could be the Queen, it could be the Prime Minister, passes through the crowd. And all of the people looking at it try to figure out who this person might be in the car with the curtains drawn. They're not sure who it is. But one of the things that comes through this is this common connection that they all have with this social association. At the bottom of page 292, we get this common experience which binds these people together. The car had gone, but it had left a slight ripple which flowed through the glove shops and the hat shops and the tailor shops on both sides of Bond Street. For 30 seconds, all heads were inclined the same way, to the window, choosing a pair of gloves. Should they be to the elbow or above it? Lemon or pale gray? Lady stopped. When the sentence was finished, something had happened. Something so trifling in single instances that no mathematical instrument, though capable of transmitting shocks in China, could register the vibration, yet in its fullness rather formidable, and in its common appeal emotional, for in all the hat shops and tailor shops, strangers looked at each other and thought of the dead, of the flag, of empire. In a public house on the back street, a colonial insulted the House of Windsor, which led to words, broken beer glasses, and a general shindy, which echoed strangely across the way in the ears of girls buying white underlinen threatened with pure white ribbon for their weddings. For the surface agitation of the passing cars, it sunk grace something very profound. And so this common knowledge, common experience, and common belief is something that binds people together. On page 351, Clarissa reveals how she contributes to this sense of life that helps people survive in the face of existential loneliness. She says, as she is remembering her past, as she is contemplating her daughter Elizabeth and her daughter Elizabeth's relationship with Doris Kilman, Miss Kilman, who is one of the evil influences in the novel, she explains why she offers the parties that neither Richard nor Peter can understand. Remember, Peter was the one who made fun of her as being the perfect hostess, which he intended as an insult. But in fact, she is a hostess, and that's her offering. Her parties. That was it. Her parties. Both of them criticized her very unfairly, laughed at her very unjustly for her parties. That was it. That was it. Well, how was she going to defend herself? Now that she knew what it was, she felt perfectly happy. They thought, or Peter at any rate thought, that she enjoyed imposing herself, liked to have famous people about her, great names, was simply a snob in short. Well, Peter might think so. Richard merely thought it was foolish for her to like excitement when she knew it was bad for her heart. It was childish, he thought, and both were quite wrong. What she liked was simply life. That's what I do it for, she said, speaking aloud at life. So how we establish life is by establishing connections with other human beings who die. Those common connections between us is what allows us to live on in the face of mortality and existential meaningless and the lack of any sort of transcendental realm or truth. But to go deeper, beneath what people said and these judgments, how superficial, how fragmentary they are, in her own mind now, what did it mean to her, this thing she called life? Oh, it was very queer. Here was so-and-so in South Kensington, someone up in Bayswater, and somebody else, say, in Mayfair. And she felt quite continuously a sense of their existence. And she felt what a waste. And she felt what a pity. And she felt if only they could be brought together. So she did it. And it was an offering to combine, to create. But to whom? An offering for the sake of offering, perhaps. Anyhow, it was her gift. Nothing else she had of the slightest importance. She could not think, write, even play the piano. On page 326, Peter recognizes how her parties bring people together and create a new social fabric. These parties, for example, were all for him, or for her idea of him. To do Richard justice, he would have been happier farming in Norfolk. She had made her drawing room a sort of meeting place. She had a genius for it. Over and over again he had seen her take some raw youth, twist him, turn him, wake him up, set him going. Infinite numbers of dull people conglomerated around her, of course. But odd, unexpected people turned up. An artist sometimes, sometimes a writer. Queer fish in that atmosphere. And behind it all was that network of visiting, leaving cards, being kind to people, running about with bunches of flowers, little presents. So-and-so was going to France. He must have an air cushion, a real drain on her strength, all that interminable traffic that women of her sort keep up. But she did it genuinely, from natural instinct. Clarissa Dalloway's response to the loneliness and isolation of postmodern existential alienation is to create new social connections, to make the memories that bind people together so that they have these shared memories that bind Peter Walsh and Sally Seton together later and bind Peter to Clarissa even though they haven't seen each other for 20 years. Every plot must have its villain, its antagonist. And in this novel, the antagonist is represented by Dr. Holmes and Sir William Bradshaw, who, in one way or another, try to enforce their idea of an old social order, which no longer works, onto the people who are trying to build a new way of seeing the world and reestablish social connections. Dr. Holmes is guilty of profound stupidity, and Sir William Bradshaw's malevolence is an attempt to reinforce a traditional sense of order that he calls a sense of proportion. Dr. Holmes is mentioned a couple of times earlier in the text when Rizzio remembers what Dr. Holmes has said, but he appears in person on page 334. Dr. Holmes came again. Large, fresh-colored, handsome, flicking his boots, looking in the glass, he brushed it all aside. Headaches, sleeplessness, fears, dreams, nerve symptoms, and nothing more, he said. If Dr. Holmes found himself even half a pound below 11 stone 6, he asked his wife for another plate of porridge at breakfast. Rizzio would learn to cook porridge. But, he continued, health is largely a matter in our own control. Throw yourself into outside interests. Take up some hobby, he opened Shakespeare. Antony and Cleopatra pushed Shakespeare aside. Some hobby, said Dr. Holmes, for did he not owe his own excellent health, and he worked as hard as any man in London, to the fact that he could always switch off from his patients on to old furniture? And what a very pretty comb, if you might say so, Mrs. Warren Smith was wearing. When the damn fool came again, Septimus refused to see him. Did he indeed, said Dr. Holmes, smiling agreeably. Really, he had to give that charming little lady, Mrs. Smith, a friendly push before he could get past her into her husband's bedroom. So, you're in a funk, he said agreeably, sitting down by his patient's side. He had actually talked of killing himself to his wife. Quite a girl, a foreigner, wasn't she? Didn't that give her a very odd idea of English husbands? Didn't one owe, perhaps, a duty to one's wife? Wouldn't it be better to do something instead of lying in bed? For he had 40 years' experience behind him, and Septimus could take Dr. Holmes' word for it. There was nothing whatever the matter with him. And next time Dr. Holmes came, he hoped to find Smith out of bed and not making that charming little lady his wife anxious about him. Human nature, in short, was on him. The repulsive brute with blood-red nostrils. Holmes was on him. Dr. Holmes came quite regularly every day. Once you stumble, Septimus wrote on the back of a postcard, human nature is on you. Holmes is on you. Their only chance was to escape without letting Holmes know, to Italy, anywhere, anywhere away from Dr. Holmes. So Dr. Holmes is the one who stupidly refuses to admit the existence of shell shock or the problems of depression, very much like the person who, when coming across someone who is clinically depressed, tells them to cheer up, just smile, it'll make you feel better. So Dr. Holmes' problem is stupidity. Sir William Bradshaw, on the other hand, has a much deeper malevolence. Sir William Bradshaw is the psychiatrist to whom Septimus Smith has been referred as a result of his threatening to kill himself. And he has earned his social position and his knighthood by enforcing the rules of proper behavior, what he calls his sense of proportion. He's made himself wealthy and provided for his family as a result of his ability to enforce these rules on the people of society who, for some reason or another, don't seem to be able to follow his sense of proportion. We're told that Sir William Bradshaw himself is rich, that he's the doctor of the wealthy, and that he would travel 60 miles or more down into the country to visit the rich, the afflicted, who could afford the very large fee which Sir William very properly charged for his advice, while his wife, her ladyship, waits in the car. Sir William himself was no longer young. He had worked very hard. He had won his position by sheer ability, being the son of a shopkeeper, loved his profession, made a fine figurehead at ceremonies, and spoke well, all of which, by the time he was knighted, given him a heavy look, a weary look, the stream of patients being so incessant and the responsibilities and privileges of his profession so onerous, which weariness, together with his gray hairs, increased the extraordinary distinction of his presence and gave him the reputation of the utmost importance in dealing with nerve cases, not merely of lightning skill and almost infallible accuracy in diagnosis, but of sympathy, tact, understanding of the human soul. He could see the first moment they came into the room, the Warren Smiths, they were called. He was certain directly he saw the man. It was a case of extreme gravity. It was a case of complete breakdown, complete physical and nervous breakdown with every symptom in an advanced stage, he ascertained in 2 or 3 minutes, writing answers to questions murmured discreetly on a pink card. He ascertained in 2 or 3 minutes Septimus's problem. And then after a few minutes asking Septimus questions in order to diagnose his case of shell shock, the narrator tells us how Sir William Bradshaw treats cases of such extreme gravity. It was merely a question of rest, referring, of course, to the rest cure, which was isolating someone from anyone they know or any human contact for 6 months or more, feeding them minimal amounts of food in order to minimize sensory deprivation. It was a common cure of the time, one that we can see exemplified in Catherine Gilman's short story, The Yellow Wallpaper, in which the cure actually drives the woman crazy, and one that Sir William is going to prescribe for Septimus. Of rest, rest, a long rest in bed. There was a delightful home down in the country where her husband would be perfectly looked after. Away from her, she asked? Unfortunately, yes. The people we care for most are not good for us when we are ill. But he was not mad, was he? Sir William said he never spoke of madness. He called it not having a sense of proportion. But her husband did not like doctors. He would refuse to go there. Shortly and kindly, Sir William explained to her the state of the case. He had threatened to kill himself. There was no alternative. It was a question of law. He would lie in bed in a beautiful house in the country. The nurses were admirable. Sir William would visit him once a week. If Mrs. Warren Smith was quite sure, she had no more questions to ask. He never hurried. His patience. They would return to her husband. She had nothing more to ask, not of Sir William. So why is Sir William seen as such a threat, not only to Septimus, but to society in general? He represents, through his sense of proportion, a desire to impose upon people a sense of propriety and order from previous generations. In other words, he's taking Victorian sense of propriety, gentility, and respectability and turning it into a medical diagnosis and attempting to enforce on people a sense of behavior and appropriateness that no longer works in a post-positivist society. And the novel clearly dislikes what he represents. To his patients, he gave 3/4 of an hour. And if in this exacting science, which has to do with what, after all, we know nothing about, the nervous system, the human brain, a doctor loses his sense of proportion as a doctor he fails. Health we must have, and health is proportion, so that when a man comes into your room and says he is Christ, a common delusion, and has a message, as they mostly have, and threatens, as they often do, to kill himself, you invoke proportion, order rest in bed, rest in solitude, silence and rest, rest without friends, without books, without messages. 6 months rest, until a man who went in weighing 7 stone 6 comes out weighing 12. Proportion, divine proportion, Sir William's goddess, was acquired by Sir William walking hospitals, catching salmon, begetting one son in Harley Street by Lady Bradshaw, who caught salmon herself and took photographs, scarcely to be distinguished from the work of professionals. Worshipping proportion, Sir William not only prospered himself, but made England prosper. Secluded her lunatics, forbade childbirth, penalized despair, made it impossible for the unfit to propagate their views until they, too, shared his sense of proportion. His, if they were men, Lady Bradshaw's, if they were women. She embroidered, knitted, spent 4 nights out of 7 at home with her son, so that not only did his colleagues respect him, his subordinates fear him, but the friends and relations of his patients felt for him the keenest gratitude for insisting that these prophetic Christs and Christesses, who prophesied the end of the world, or the advent of God, should drink milk in bed, as Sir William ordered. Sir William, with his 30 years' experience of these kinds of cases, and his infallible instinct, this is madness, this is sense, in fact, his sense of proportion. So clearly, he is being criticized for imposing his beliefs about propriety of behavior on individuals who, like Septimus, have seen a truth that he can't recognize or that he doesn't want to recognize because it threatens his role in the social order. This sense of proportion is a much more malevolent version of what Dickens had described as podsnappery in Our Mutual Friend, which we discussed in an earlier video, in which Mr. Podsnap sees life and everything in life in terms of getting up at 7, shaving close at 9:15, breakfasting at 9, going to the city at 10, etc., etc. It's an imposition of a bourgeois sense of propriety and respectability. But also, the narrator goes on to tell us that this desire for propriety and respectability has a colonial aspect. But proportion has a sister, less smiling, more formidable, a goddess even now engaged in the heat and sands of India, the mud and swamp of Africa, the purlieus of London, wherever, in short, the climate or the devil tempts men to fall from the true belief which is her own, is even now engaged in slashing down shrines, smashing idols, and settling up in their place her own stern countenance. Conversion is her name, and she feasts upon the wills of the weakly, loving to impress, to impose, adoring her own features stamped on the face of the populace. So this notion of proportion becomes the notion of conversion, the sense of colonialism which attempts to impose an ideology on other people, trying to gain control over these other people by stamping on them her own face. This lady, too, Rizzio Warren Smith had divined it, had her dwelling in Sir William's heart, though concealed, as she mostly is, under some plausible disguise, some venerable name, love, duty, self-sacrifice. So why is this such a threat to personality and individuality? Why does this threat evoke John Stuart Mill's notion of conformity and of that harsh, dreaded censorship of the middle class? Well, we can see, for an example, Lady Bradshaw. But conversion, fastidious goddess, loves blood better than brick and feasts most subtly on the human will. For example, Lady Bradshaw. 15 years ago she had gone under. It was nothing you could put your finger on. There had been no scene, no snap, only the slow sinking, waterlogged of her will into his. Sweet was her smile, swift her submission. Dinner in Harley Street, numbering 8 or 9 courses, feeding 10 or 15 guests of the professional classes, was smooth in her brain. Only as the evening wore on, a very slight dullness, or uneasiness perhaps, a nervous twitch, fumble or stumble, and confusion indicated what it was really painful to believe, that the poor lady lied. Once, long ago, she had caught salmon freely. Now quick to minister to the craving which lit her husband's eye so oilily for dominion, for power, she cramped, squeezed, pared, pruned, drew back, peeped through, so that without knowing precisely what made the evening disagreeable and caused this pressure on the top of the head, which might well be imputed to the professional conversation or the fatigue of a great doctor whose life, Lady Bradshaw said, is not his own but his patient's, disagreeable it was, so that guests, when the clock struck 10, breathed in the air of Harley Street even with rapture, which relief, however, was denied to his patients. So Sir William Bradshaw imposes his will on his wife, but even more forcefully imposes his will on his patients. He lacked a sense of proportion. And perhaps, after all, there is no God? He shrugged his shoulders. In short, this living or not living is an affair of our own? But they were mistaken. Sir William had a friend in Surrey where they taught what Sir William frankly admitted was a difficult art, a sense of proportion. There were, moreover, family affections, honor, courage, and a brilliant career. All of these had in Sir William a resolute champion. If they failed them, he had to support police and the good of society, which, he remarked very quietly, would take care down in Surrey that these unsocial impulses, bred more than anything by a lack of good blood, were held in control. And then stole out from her hiding place and mounted her throne that goddess whose lust is to override opposition, to stamp indelibly in the sanctuaries of others the image of herself. Naked, defenseless, the exhausted, the friendless received the impress of Sir William's will. He swooped, he devoured, he shut people up. It was his combination of decision and humanity that endeared Sir William so greatly to the relations of his victims. But Rizzio Warren Smith cried, walking down Harley Street, that she did not like that man. Shredding and slicing, dividing and subdividing, the clocks of Harley Street nibbled at the June day, counseled submission, upheld authority, and pointed out in chorus the supreme advantages of a sense of proportion. So Sir William Bradshaw's sense of proportion, which he imposes upon his patients against their will in an attempt to maintain order, which, if his patients don't submit, he has the support of the police. Remember Marlowe's discussion of stepping delicately between the policeman and the butcher? In holy terror of gallows and lunatic asylums. Clearly, Sir William Bradshaw is aligned with that sense of social control. And finally, that sense of social control is aligned with clock time, which is very different from the experiential time that governs this novel. So in the face of an old and oppressive order that no longer works, represented by Sir William Bradshaw in a sense of proportion, and in an attempt to form a new basis for some sort of social connection, Clarissa Dalloway gives her party to conclude the day that this novel is represented. Into Clarissa's party come the Bradshaws, and the Bradshaws bring information about Septimus's suicide. Now, Clarissa has never met Septimus, has never heard about him before this moment, and this is the first that she's heard of him or his problems. But nevertheless, Septimus's suicide has a great significance to Clarissa, although one that one might not expect. She finds in Septimus's suicide an affirmation. If we look at page 386, Clarissa grapples with the news of Septimus's suicide. She's left the party. She's alone in a room. What business had the Bradshaws to talk of death at her party? The young man had killed himself, and they talked of it at her party. The Bradshaws talked of death. He had killed himself. But how? Always her body went through it first when she was told suddenly of an accident. Her dress flamed, her body burnt. He had thrown himself from a window. Up flashed the ground. Through him, blundering, bruising, went the rusty spikes. There he lay with a thud, thud, thud in his brain, and then a suffocation of blackness. So she saw it. But why had he done it? And the Bradshaws talked of it at her party. She had once thrown a shilling into the serpentine, never anything more. But he had flung it away. They went on living. She would have to go back. The rooms were still crowded. People kept on coming. They, all day she had been thinking of Burton, of Peter, of Sally. They would grow old. A thing there was that mattered. A thing wreathed about with chatter, defaced, obscured in her own life. Let drop every day in corruption, lies, chatter. This he had preserved. Death was defiance. Death was an attempt to communicate. People feeling the impossibility of reaching the center which mystically evaded them. Closeness drew apart. Rapture faded. One was alone. There was an embrace in death. But this young man who had killed himself, had he plunged holding his treasure? If it were now to die, 'twere now to be most happy, she had said to herself once, coming down in white. Or there were the poets and the thinkers. Suppose he had that passion, and had gone to Sir William Bradshaw, great doctor, yet to her obscurely evil, without sex or lust, extremely polite to women, but capable of some indescribable outrage. Forcing your soul, that was it. If this young man had gone to him and Sir William had impressed him like that with his power, might he not then have said, indeed she felt it now, life is made intolerable, they make life intolerable, men like that. That is exactly the conclusion to which Septimus comes. Sir William Bradshaw's forcing his soul into conformity is what provoked Septimus to commit suicide. And Septimus, by defying Bradshaw and embracing death, has now established some depth of meaning, some common ground in death that Clarissa finds understandable, comprehensible. Now, I'm not even close to fully reconciling the themes of this novel in my head or fully understanding how this represents a conclusion for Clarissa or for the novel. So the best I can do is give you some suggestion about the major themes and how I see them vaguely interacting here, and I'm going to let you draw your own conclusions about what that means. On the one hand, we have Clarissa, who has sought to establish some method of surviving death by establishing social connections and by helping others establish social connections so that their memories become dispersed and disseminated throughout all of the social connections that they establish in some sort of social matrix, and that they survive in the memories and the effects that they have on others in the same way that the memory of her relationship with Peter has guided him over the past 30 years while he's been separated and away from her in India. And then on the other hand, we have the theme of Septimus. Septimus, who recognizes that people hunt in packs, that there is no connection between people in society, and that ultimately the only reality is our connection with the dead, because we too must die. And finally, realizing that himself in his own suicide. And so I see these as complementary halves of a different whole, and that they mean something only when you bring them together. And I think that that's what Clarissa is getting at here at this point in the novel, because her communication means nothing unless it is grounded in some reality, and that reality in which it's grounded is the reality of death. On the other hand, his death means nothing unless it is established in some sort of communication network, unless it becomes part of this social fabric that Clarissa is trying to weave. Without death, communication means nothing. Without communication, death means nothing. It's only when the two things come together that they gain some sort of mutually interdependent meaning. And so in this passage, I see this from the way Clarissa describes what Septimus has done and how it changes the way that she sees her society. She sees society as wreathed about with chatter, defaced, obscured in its own life, let drop every day in corruption, lies, and chatter, meaningless talk. This he had preserved. Death was defiance. Death was an attempt to communicate. People feeling the impossibility of reaching the center, which mystically evaded them. Closeness drew apart. Rapture faded. One was alone. There was an embrace in death. Unless it is placed within the context of understanding that we all have death in common, communication is nothing. It's simply chatter. It's meaningless. Death is defiance. Death is communication. Death is the thing that binds us together. And so Septimus's self-sacrifice for society gives to Clarissa's attempts to build society again on the basis of some sort of social fabric meaning. In dying, Septimus preserves the possibility of some sort of meaning within society, some sort of imminent transcendence that ties people together. And so Septimus's death is the death of someone who continues to live on in Clarissa's memory and in the meaning that he has given to her society. So when she says, "Fear no more the heat of the sun," she's repeating the lines that came up at the beginning of the novel, spoken over Imogen, who is both dead and not dead at the same time. The young man had killed himself, but she did not pity him. With the clock striking the hour, 1, 2, 3, she did not pity him with all this going on. There, the old lady had put out her light. The whole house was dark now with this going on, she repeated, and the words came to her, "Fear no more the heat of the sun." She must go back to them. But what an extraordinary night. She felt somehow very like him, the young man who had killed himself. She felt glad that he had done it, thrown it away. The clock was striking. The leaden circles dissolved in the air. He made her feel the beauty, made her feel the fun. But she must go back. She must assemble. She must find Sally and Peter. And she came in from the little room. And so Septimus, in some way, through his suicide, through establishing the commonality of death, through defying the order that is represented by clock time and by Sir William Bradshaw, has helped establish for Clarissa some sense of meaning and order in the companionship of others through the ability to communicate about the commonality of death. And then, of course, at the end of the novel, on page 392, Clarissa reappears at her party, standing at the top of her stairs, the perfect hostess. "It is Clarissa," he said, for there she was.